After Mars, Venus is the planet that most inspired science fiction authors, who often imagined it inhabited by more or less complex forms of life. For example, the series of novels of The Cycle of Venus by Edgar Rice Burroughs focuses on the figure of Carson, a terrestrial adventurer shipwrecked on a hostile world who must fight to restore justice to the people and conquer the princess. Other authors of this period represented Venus as a swampy planet or an ocean planet, in the latter case complete with underwater cities, ranging from Infinity by Olaf Stapleton to Lee Brackett, up to One of the Adventures of Lucky Star, one of the series of Isaac Asimov's novels. Venus is also the background to some stories by Alfred E. Van Vogt and Ray Bradbury. But all in these cases, the interest in the planet is mainly that of a different world and far from the Earth, without really questioning its real conditions of habitability. In other novels, Venus has become an interesting example of terraforming and colonization. The term terraforming means a hypothetical, and for now science fiction, planetary engineering process aimed at transforming Venus or another planet into a planet suitable for the survival of human life. For example, by growing forests to increase the amount of oxygen in the atmosphere, or by melting the ice caps at the poles to obtain liquid water. This new course includes novels and short stories that try to give a scientifically accurate vision of the planet, such as Hell by Larry Niven, which takes its cue from an exploratory mission to tell the conditions of Venus, or Venus by Ben Bova. The colonization of Venus is the starting point for several other stories, such as Frederick Pohl's The Merchants of Venus, a socio-political satire placed in the Heechee cycle, in which the economic reasons that allowed to proceed to the terraforming of the planet are given. Frank Herbert also wrote the novel Man of Two Worlds with his son Brian, which sees a war on Venus between the colonizing powers of the world. Kim Stanley Robinson instead tells in 2312 of the terraforming of the planet carried out by China, with the use of a screen to deflect the sun's rays and lower the temperature. But could we colonize Venus? Would it be possible to live there? Let's try to understand it. Venus, in ancient Greece, was identified with Aphrodite, goddess of love and beauty. It was also known by the names of Evening Star or Morning Star. This is because it is usually visible shortly after sunset or just before sunrise. To the unaided eye, it appears as a very bright point that shines with a fixed light. This is a way to distinguish a planet from a star with the naked eye, because a planet reflects the light of the sun and shines with a fixed light, while the proper light of a star is more flickering. The star is said to spark. With a magnitude of minus 4.6, Venus is the brightest celestial body in the night sky after the moon. Through a telescope, it is possible to observe its phase. As the Italian astronomer Galileo Galilei already noticed in the 1600s, but from the Earth, it is not possible to do much more, due to the thick layer of clouds that envelop the planet. In size and mass, it is very similar to the Earth, as is the acceleration of gravity, equal to about 0.88 times that of the Earth. That is, a 70-kilogram man on Earth would weigh only 62 kilograms on Venus. Another similarity to the Earth is its volcanoes. It has about 1,500 of them of medium to large size, but there could be millions more of them smaller. The presence of sulfur in the atmosphere suggests that volcanic activity is still very active. But the similarities with our planet end there, as we will see shortly. Venus is the second closest planet to the Sun after the small planet Mercury. Its distance from our star is 0.7 astronomical units, equal to about 100 million kilometers from the Sun. The astronomical unit is the average distance between the Earth and the Sun, equal to approximately 150 million kilometers. It follows that the distance between Venus and the Earth is about 50 million kilometers. So if we could travel to Venus aboard an airliner, it would take a little over 60 years to reach it. And this, in view of a hypothetical colonization of the planet, must be adequately taken into account, because the effects on human psychology of such long-lasting space missions are not known. also how to protect human crews from interplanetary space radiation and cosmic rays. In the long run, this radiation is believed to cause some types of diseases and genetic mutations. An idea being studied by various space agencies is to shield the spaceship with gigantic tanks full of water. But how to carry all this water while consuming as little fuel as possible? Venus travels its almost circular orbit around the Sun in about 224 days, while its rotation period is 243 days. Practically a day on Venus lasts longer than its year. And there is also another peculiarity. Its rotational motion is retrograde. Put simply, on Venus, the Sun rises in the western horizon and sets in the eastern horizon. This happens because, due to some unknown phenomenon or a primordial cataclysm or a long-term effect on the chaotic atmosphere, the axis of Venus is inclined 177 degrees with respect to the ecliptic plane. In other words, the planet rotates on itself in the right direction counterclockwise, but is upside down. The North Pole is down and the South Pole up, and this causes the rotation motion to appear inverted. A hypothetical crew on a Venusian mission would certainly be a little bewildered by this fact, but in reality it would have to worry about much more serious and urgent problems. If it were suddenly catapulted there without protection, in a few moments it would end up fried, intoxicated, and crushed in the soil. Responsible for this horrible end would be the Venusian atmosphere, a hellish hood formed by highly reflective clouds, composed of 96% carbon dioxide and the rest of molecular nitrogen, plus traces of other elements and compounds. This very dense blanket exerts a pressure on the ground of 95 atmospheres, equivalent to that experienced on Earth at a depth of 1 kilometer under the sea. Furthermore, carbon dioxide, which dominates everything, is responsible for a gigantic greenhouse effect, which makes Venus the hottest planet in the solar system, a natural oven with a ground temperature of about 470 degrees centigrade, even higher than that of Mercury, in spite of the latter's shorter distance from the Sun. Precisely because of the large greenhouse effect, this temperature would be more or less the same throughout the planet. Let's imagine then that our hypothetical space explorer landed on Venus, protected by a kind of indestructible bathyscape, able to withstand pressures similar to those of the ocean and temperatures capable of melting lead and zinc. What heaven would this fearless traveler see? Nothing memorable, unfortunately. The planet is in fact perpetually enveloped in an impenetrable shroud of clouds, formed by 3 superimposed layers located between 50 and 70 kilometers of altitude, inside which a rain of sulfuric acid is produced, which due to atmospheric pressure and heat ends up vaporized before reaching the ground. Those perennial clouds prevent us from observing the sky from the surface of the planet. If there were ever living beings on Venus, certainly they were not astronomers. To understand the effect produced by such a cloudy layer, just think that its optical depth, i.e. the level of opacity, is 25. For comparison, that of the Earth's atmosphere, including clouds, varies between 0.5 and 1.5. The cloud layer is also in continuous and swirling motion. Powerful winds present at high altitudes, which blow up to 360 kilometers per hour, make the cloud cover complete an entire tour of the planet from east to west in just 4 Earth days. This is really strange, considering that the rotation motion of Venus is very slow. However, the cloud cover does not prevent light from filtering into the ground, where visibility is quite good and winds are very weak. As the images sent by the Soviet Venera probes have shown, the panorama that is observed from the surface of Venus is surrounded by a yellow-white light, which allows you to see the landscape in the distance, and the Sun would appear as a lighter spot in a very cloudy sky. The dense atmosphere of Venus represents an obstacle not only for humans, but also for probes, and therefore also for the collection of rock samples. The Soviet Venera 4 probe stopped working when the pressure exceeded 15 atmospheres, only a small fraction of the 93 ATM present on the planet's surface. The Venera 5 and Venera 6 probes were destroyed by pressure at a height of 18 kilometers above the ground, and the later Venera 7 and Venera 8 landers withstood the surface conditions for no more than an hour. So what could be the steps to follow to colonize Venus? One of the first things to do would be to reduce the planet's temperature, then eliminate the carbon dioxide and create an oxygen atmosphere. Through a terraforming process in 1961, Carl Sagan suggested terraforming Venus through algae that convert carbon dioxide of the planet in hydrogen. However, nowadays it is known that water on the planet is so rare that even with the best results from photosynthesis, only a negligible amount of oxygen would be produced. Robert Zurbin, following a study by Paul Birch in 1991, proposed the use of a large solar shield formed by floating cities, with the dual purpose of functioning as temporary dwellings awaiting better conditions on the Venusian surface, and to defend Venus from the sun and cool it sufficiently to allow the liquefaction of gases at a temperature below 31 degrees centigrade. Below this particular temperature, carbon dioxide from the atmosphere would settle on the ground in the form of dry ice and could be buried or collected and shipped out of the planet. Later, the solar shield would be removed, and due to the lowering of greenhouse gases, the problem of pressure and temperature would be solved. However, Zubrin acknowledges that lack of water remains a serious problem, and bombardment with ice-containing comets or asteroids would also take a very long time. Birch hypothesizes to disintegrate an icy moon of Saturn and bombard the planet with the fragments to provide about 100 meters of water per meter squared. Salty and shallow seas would then be created. As a solar shield, Landis proposed to use floating cities. If they were built in carbon nanotubes, then the main material for the structures, carbon, could be obtained using carbon dioxide collected from the atmosphere. Another possibility for colonization is to use the space around the planet to capture comets and asteroids and build bases there. Energy supply could be obtained through large photovoltaic solar panel systems orbiting Venus, making the planet potentially ideal for industrial development. Another way to terraform Venus would be to bring large quantities of hydrogen to the planet, probably from some source in the outer solar system. Hydrogen reacting with carbon dioxide would instantly produce elemental carbon, graphite, and water. According to the Bosch reaction, a chemical reaction between carbon dioxide and hydrogen that produces carbon in the form of graphite, water, and heat. In conclusion, could we colonize Venus? Perhaps in the distant future, but in practice, there is still a long way to go, because a lot of new technology needs to be developed to ensure the survival of human beings on a hostile and harsh world. And the terraforming process itself could take millions of years. And it is not certain that it will be successful, because the slightest error would be enough to plunge Venus back into the infernal conditions in which it currently finds itself.